I'm so glad to see you. Come on in. Make yourself at home.
Good morning. Here, you can take... Oh, I guess you don't need one of these. How about you grab a cup of coffee instead?
Good morning and welcome to West Vancouver United Church. We gather in many collected locations this morning. Wherever it is that you are listening in from, the one Spirit knits us all together as one, and we worship as one people of God. We trust that you are on a faith journey and that God continues to call you into abundant life as only God can. And we are just grateful that your path of faith has joined with ours this morning. My name is Jill Jackson. I'm a candidate for ministry with the United Church, and I am joined this morning by a small group of fellow leaders. I have the lead minister, Reverend Philip Newman, music minister, Gerald Van Wyck, the delightful Risa Takahashi, and I thank our tech team. We have Brian, Gwen, Takahira, and Sherry. And at home, if you're joining us on Facebook, your host today is Mimi Toma. Reverend Simon Lesueur continues on a family vacation, well earned after a week of study leave working on his PhD papers. And I invite you this morning to sing along with the music, embrace yourself in the prayers, and perhaps even consider inviting someone you would long to join in the service with you by passing on the link or pressing like on the Facebook page. Just a reminder, there will be no Zoom time for coffee after the service today, so don't look for that. That's having a rest, and we'll be back in action in the fall. So just a couple of announcements. Yesterday, as the sun came out, so did many of our neighbors for the parking lot sale. And we'd just like to thank Diane Allen and the team of volunteers that made that event happen. And it was such a wonderful way for the community to learn about what we do outside of these walls and to merge their lives and our lives together with very safe social distancing. A few weeks ago, we interviewed a young lady, Kathy Keene Merchant, who was a Buddhist social activist. And she wanted us to know that at the end of August, on two Saturdays, she will be running her Zoom course on compassionate listening. And a few of you have shown interest in doing that course, and so more information will be in the bulletin next week. It is with sadness that we inform you of the passing of Barry Gosney on August 3rd, and we hope and pray that you can keep the family in your prayers. And finally, this Sunday is the 10th wedding anniversary of Chris and Christine Booten, and they have so generously provided these gorgeous flowers in the sanctuary for us this morning to celebrate their special day. And we are just so grateful to have their vibrant family life as part of our family life. And we pray that Christ continues to be a light in their relationship. And I invite the Bhutans and their gorgeous daughter, Melanie, to light the Christ candle for us this morning.
Hello, friends.
Hi.
Hello.
We're the Bhutan family.
I'm Christine.
I'm Melanie.
And I'm Chris.
We're here at our home in North Vancouver, not too far from many of you. And we're delighted and honored to be asked to light the Christ candle this morning.
And as it turns out, we're also celebrating our 10th wedding anniversary today, which is a very special occasion. And we hope that we can spend many more decades together.
Our faith and love of God has kept us growing strong.
And as we face many uncertain times through this COVID-19 pandemic, we hope that our faith will continue to carry us through so that we can continue to love, laugh, and cherish all that God has given us.
In a world that often feels overwhelmed by waves of bad news, we often feel like disciples at sea, tossed and turned in the chaos of current events. But we are part of a dream. We are part of God's great dream. And we are not alone in this time of storms and turmoil. There is a presence reaching into our lives, offering calm and peace and hope. There is a dream that is being fulfilled through our very lives, God's dream of abundant love, life. And come, let us dream of possibilities today. Let us be God's people in worship, for in our worship, we reach new shores. And in our worship, God's dream is fulfilled. Come, let us worship in hope, in anticipation, and in faith. And now I invite you to join with me using the words of our gathering prayer. Today, the words you don't have, but the words are within me. And so I'm going to offer those prayers to you, and let us pray. Here we are, holy dreamer. your people. Here we are carrying our dreams in our spirits, and at the same time, wondering what your dream is for us. Here we are tossed about in a sea of anxiety and conflict, holding fast to the edges of our known reality, yet hopeful that even our current uncertainty is somehow part of your great dream for humanity and this planet. Come to us, we pray, as Jesus came to the disciples in that stormy sea many years ago. Come to us as Reuben came to the rescue of his brother Joseph. Come to us and bring your calming touch and faithful presence into our awareness. Enter our boat and be in our midst in ways so tangible that we have no more room for doubt or fear. Come to us and anchor our confidence in your grace. And now let us listen with confidence as Risa sings the prayer of Jesus.
Thank you.
These pandemic times have provided us with a prime opportunity to work at our personal prayer lives, and this includes myself, and one of the wonderful teachers I've been learning from is called Father Martin Laird. And one of the questions he often asks to help deepen our path into prayer is, who does God want to be for you today? Do you need God to hold you? Do you need God to advocate for you? Do you need God to recruit you for action? Who do you need God to be for you today? And one of the ways Father Laird suggests we deepen into prayer is through an authenticity and honesty with our feelings in this very moment. So for the first part of this prayer today, I hope to lead you, and I hope that you will join me in inviting you into the empty spaces of silence to enter your own words, and we work together to make this a prayer for you. And in the second half of the prayer, we open that up into a more global missionary type of prayer. So let's pray together. God, sometimes I feel mute before you. How do we speak the truth of who we are and what we're feeling with you, the creator of the universe? But God, we dare today to show up before you just as we are. And so, Lord, we name this morning into this silence what we're feeling today, right in this moment. And Lord, as we check in with ourselves and feel these feelings, we hand them over to you, for Christ to illuminate them for us. What is it we need to know? Open our ears in the silence to hear what it is you are saying to us this day. God, we are each asking and yearning and seeking. In the silence, we ask you, who do you want to be for each of us right now? God, give us the patience to wait for you to answer and the perseverance to see you come into this craziness of this life, where people are being misled, deceived, and neglected in a time of crisis. God of compassion, hear the cries of those in Bangladesh whose lives have been affected by flooding. Be to them a firm foundation on which to build their lives. God who weeps with us, be amongst those mourning in Beirut following the ammonium explosion. God of good hope, keep us united so we find our hope together as we continue to navigate our way through these pandemic days safely and wisely. And God of extraordinary kindness, open your heart for those we love, for the Gosney family, Gary, Astrid, Bob, Donnie, Doris, Reg, Judy, Colt, Georgia, Alistair, Terry, Amanda, Bradford, Victoria, Carol, and Leslie, Bernie, Jason and family, Susie and Ross. God of great joy, thank you for these summer days. You are our salvation, and we will trust in you and not be afraid, for you, our Lord, our God, are our strength and our song. Amen. For the scripture reading today, Reverend Philip has chosen three short passages from the Hebrew Bible prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Zechariah. And as we prepare to hear God's word, let us first pray. O God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and in love. Amen. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. And finally, Zechariah chapter 9, verse 12. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Shadow of the life, say to the
Thank you so much, Risa and Jerry. That's just one of my favorite pieces. Friends, we are exploring the theme of hope for the month of August. And last Sunday, you may remember I took a look in the Psalms. And today I'm going to look at the prophets, where we can find a lot of hope. But first, I want to share this. Birthdays are important occasions. This year, our youngest son turned 35. Normally, he would get together with his friends, most of whom are married with kids, but not this year. COVID-19 is keeping us apart. And this son lives alone, and admittedly, he has found the isolation somewhat difficult at times. One of his buddies texted him saying, "Hey, if you're gonna be home on your birthday, I'd like to drive over and have an outdoor visit from my car to your front door." And my son agreed to this. What my son did not know was that this buddy had arranged with all of the group of his friends to have a drive-by birthday celebration. And our son's buddy arrived at the appointed time. And within minutes, there was a cacophony of car horns blaring coming down the street. His friends rolled down their windows and out popped happy birthday banners and balloons. And then the neighbors heard the commotion, and a number of them came out to their front lawns and enjoyed the celebrations. According to my son, it was the most memorable birthday. It's an example of how we are doing things differently. The message given to my son by his group of friends was, "We care about you." And I'm so glad they delivered that message with me being so many provinces away from him. I want him to know that he is cared for and loved. And that begins to get at the message today. As you know, we are talking about hope. Not just the hope that God gives to us, but how it is that God gives us that hope. And one of the ways God gives us hope and love is through other people. And as we begin to explore that, let's first pray. Well, Lord, may I never lightly presume to speak your word, nor may we ever lightly presume to hear your word, for in your word is life. Abundant life. Amen. 3 months ago, one of our dear friends was in hospital and struggling. She had some compromised health issues. She was diabetic, and she'd received some treatments for a melanoma over the past year. She was admitted to hospital to recalibrate her medications associated with her diabetes, which had been affected by the chemotherapy. It was discovered that she was COVID positive. That put a whole new spin on the situation. Her husband and her two daughters were tested. All were found to be COVID positive. They were not permitted to enter the hospital, of course. It became apparent that even the respirator was not able to offer much help. As they had their final video link with her, the attending nurse said to them, "I know how much you love her and adore her. You can't be in here, but I can. I will stay right by her side. I won't leave her alone. She will know that you love her and that God loves her." And she passed away. As they went that evening as a threesome to the lakeshore, where they often went as a family to watch the sunset together, they felt the assurance that their mom and wife was in God's remarkable care, that she died knowing she was not alone, that she was well loved, and that God's light would shine on their lives even in that terrible moment of loss and beyond. Now, You remember, I hope, that last week I gave you a verse to memorize. Do you recall that? It was from Psalm 40, and here it is on your screen. I put all my hope in the Lord. Last Sunday, we explored the notion that hope is holding on tight to the trust that we place in our God, that there is a better future coming than we are experiencing in the present. Now, I also talked about three phases or seasons of life that we discover as we move through the Psalms. These are seasons that are defined by a favorite theologian of mine, Walter Brueggemann. The first season is called orientation. It's when things are going quite well with our life. These times are sometimes followed by seasons of disorientation, when life falls apart, a calamity comes our way. And this would be followed by a season of reorientation, when people felt God's deliverance and experienced joy again. And the prophets figure largely in that second season, the season of disorientation. They are ministering to the people in the midst of times of disorientation. Now, not only do they provide warnings and critique to help the people live out the ways of God, but when tragedy did come, when disasters did befall God's people, the prophets offered words of hope. And words of hope is the dominant message of the prophets. Let me offer you a little history lesson that helps tie together some of the details around all the prophets and their activities, and I'm only going to touch on a few prophets. Imagine it's the year 605 BCE. Egypt is a major empire. They control North Africa, all the land around the Nile River, nearly the entire eastern end of the Mediterranean Ocean, clear through Israel and Lebanon as we know them today. And further to the east, there is another empire which is gaining in strength, called the Babylonian Empire, and it has a new king. And he has ambitions to control everything that the little kingdoms around and the other large competitor, competing kingdom, Egypt. He wants everything they have. And the Israelites, true to form, find themselves caught between these two mighty empires. And the battle is over the control of the trade routes that pass through Judah, the land of the Israelites, because those trade routes were key to the flow of everything, really, that moved between the two continents of Africa and Asia. So really, all this intrigue is about economics and who gets to control trade and the commerce. Judah, the land of God's people, the Jews or Israelites, it was just a tiny little kingdom compared to Egypt and Babylon. Judah was only about one quarter the size of Vancouver Island. And in the year 605 BC, Judah is aligned with the older kingdom of Egypt. But then the Babylonians come and they defeat Egypt. And the Babylonians' king name is Nebuchadnezzar. And you've probably heard of him. He may be one of the greatest kings in all of history. He's mentioned 64 times in the Bible. He was a really important figure in the Old Testament books of the Bible and in ancient history. He ruled 40 years, and he has great ambitions as he expands his kingdom from the east and north. He's driving the Egyptians further south and west. Nebuchadnezzar actually goes quite easy on Judah and its capital city, Jerusalem. He lets them know that he's glad to let their king stay in place and continue to rule, but under Babylonians' oversight. The king of Babylon takes some leading people from Judah back to Babylon to be his advisors, to know how to deal with these people in this little kingdom. Four persons from Judah in particular were taken away to Babylon to live under King Nebuchadnezzar. And you will perhaps remember their names. They're names that sound like Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Jill had some fun talking about them earlier in the summer. In a few short years, the people of Judah, you know, they began to chafe under this new arrangement. They feel they're being controlled, too harshly oppressed under the Babylonians. And so it's just 6 or 7 years later that the Jews decide, we're going to give it another go. And they side with Egypt once again. And they rebel against the huge Babylonian Empire. And the uprising did not go well for the Jews or for Egypt. The entire Babylonian army is dispatched to quell this uprising. They plunder completely the temple in Jerusalem. They take the king and the queen mother and all the leading citizens of Judah, well, a choice selection of 10,000 of them, and he marches them all back to Babylon. And this is known as the first exile. The prophet Ezekiel is also one of the leaders taken back to Babylon. This military activity going on through these years is what begins to set up what happens in the prophetic books of the Bible. It informs the various themes that we see. Ezekiel was in exile with the people for many years. And so he ministers to them, he challenges them, he offers them hope. Ezekiel helps them deal also with the question of why this terrible thing has happened to them and how it is they find themselves in exile in Babylon. Meanwhile, back in Jerusalem, there's another prophet. His name's Jeremiah. And Jeremiah starts writing letters to the people who are in exile. He encourages those people to align their lives with God's ways, or bad things are going to happen. The people did not like Jeremiah's message, not the people in exile, not the few people that remained in Judah and Jerusalem. And at one point, they arrested Jeremiah and kept him under house arrest. They did not want to hear words that Jeremiah spoke, but he kept proclaiming his message that it would be a long time before they ever returned home. And after that disastrous second battle, Jeremiah said, "See, this is what I was talking about. I was trying to tell you this." And Jeremiah continued to write letters to the people who'd been taken exile in Babylon, saying, "You're not coming back for a long time. You need to settle into the land. You need to get used to it. You need to pray for the people you are living among. Pray for your captors and try to bless them. If you do this, it will go well for you. If you think only about coming back home, it will be deadly for you and for us." Another decade goes by. The Jews in Jerusalem and the kingdom of Judah, they rebel yet again. This time the full force of the Babylonian power comes down on them hard. Babylon's king Nebuchadnezzar attacked Jerusalem, leveling it. Everyone was exiled. And that was the end of the city of Jerusalem and the kingdom of Judah. And this is a hopeless situation. So at this point, you may be sitting there thinking, why do I care about all this that has happened? It's events of thousands of years ago. Why do these names matter? Well, let me tell you that this story is perhaps the most important story in the Old Testament. In terms of shaping the Hebrew text, the reason this history is recorded in the Bible and influences about 28 of the 39 books of the Old Testament is because every generation that came after this looked back to this story to see themselves in it. Because every single one of the Jews and the Christians after them did the same thing. And today we still look to the story and recognize that all of us have been in exile at some point in our lives. All of us have or will wonder, is it worth carrying on? These words of the prophets still speak to us today because we see ourselves in exile and we hear God speaking to us. When we hear the prophets speak words of hope, we think, these words are for me too. There are seasons when life is really hard and we find ourselves in disorientation. We in the world are in one of those seasons right now. We know it well. We're slowly finding how to do life again. We want deliverance, and God offers us hope. And we like things instantaneous. We like our Prime delivery from Amazon the next day, not in 2 or 3 weeks as they were offering a few months ago. God's deliverance comes slowly. It works through people, slowly, but it does come. That's what we find again and again in the biblical text. Let me just remind you of the prophet Daniel. We find that Daniel is unwilling to stop praying to his God when ordered to pray only to the king. He refuses. He's brought before the king, who says, look, don't you know that I'm going to throw you to the lions if you do not stop this practice of praying to your God? And what does Daniel do? He keeps praying to his God and is tossed into the lion's den. And you remember that suddenly the lions, they all lost their appetite. What's the message of hope for us? Well, you're going to find yourself in the lion's den at some time in your life. But God is going to walk with you. If you trust in God, you will discover God to be with you. I think about Jeremiah, and there is one particular passage in his writing that many of us know. Jeremiah is speaking to the exiles. And he says to them, you have a long time before you will return home. You won't make it. Perhaps it will be your children's children who will make it home. So settle in this land, bless the inhabitants of the land, get married there, shape your lives there, work the land. You're going to be there a long time. However, the day is coming when you will come home, or your children's children will come home. Jillian read this verse to you earlier. I know the plans I have in mind for you, declares the Lord. They are plans for peace, not disaster, to give you a future filled with hope. What this is not saying is that God is going to instantaneously deliver us. As a matter of fact, this whole chapter affirms that you're going to have to go through the tough path for a while. But God is saying to the Israelites, in the end, Babylon is not going to have the final word. Exile will not be the final move. Through this story, I hear God saying to us, in the end, this pandemic will not have the final word with us. Or it's something personal that you're going through, because our exiles are not always something we share with the rest of the world. For some, exile might be that divorce that you're still working your way through. Or exile might be the loss of a child and the grief that sticks with you. Exile might be the depression that you struggle with and that you cannot seem to shake. Whatever your exile is, what the prophet says to you is, it will not have the final word. You see, we have a future with hope. God is going to deliver us. God is going to love us. That is our promise. No matter how dark our current circumstances may be, exile does not get to have the final word for us. As I was talking on the phone with my friend whose wife and mother of his two daughters was in hospital, I thought of Isaiah, the prophet. His words of hope start in chapter 40. Comfort ye my people. And if you're familiar with Handel's Messiah, you'll know these words from Isaiah. And then you get to the end of chapter 40, and you hear, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strength to the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young, they will fall exhausted. But those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not ever faint. I'm telling you today, God is walking with you, and you are his instruments. God cares for you. God's heart breaks with you and yours. And the one thing I can do is to invite you to hold on to the Lord our God. And some of you, I know, are doing just fine right now. But a great number of you continue in a time of disorientation, and life feels hard. Know that God will see you through this. My friend, whose wife was in hospital, he was so comforted by the attending nurse who told him and his daughters that she knew how much they cared for her, how much they loved her, how much they longed to be the ones at her bedside and could not. So she promised to stay hour by hour, minute by minute, to see her through to her final hour, until she was removed from the respirator, so that she would know beyond a doubt that she was held by God's grace. You see, we convey the message of God's love. We are the vessels through which the message of hope and love move. Whether we deliver groceries to someone who's lost their job and whose shelves are empty, or whether we write a card expressing just how much we care, or pray with someone, or whether we are a nurse staying at the bedside, being the presence of compassion, we embody God's message of love. Now, last week I invited you to memorize that verse from Psalm 40. Today I'm going to give you another. And it's a little longer, and the words are beautiful. You'll see the words on the screen. And try memorizing these words this week. Those who wait for the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint. Friends, let's pray. God, help us to wait upon you, to put all our hope in you, to cling to you as one clings to a lifeline. Help us and all the world so that we might run, not grow weary, walk and not be faint. And as your hope wells up in us, O Lord, help us to be instruments of hope to our family or friends or neighbors, to those in need. Help us offer ourselves to you as we give thanks to you. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Friends, may I just express our thanks for your making the time to join together in worship. There are lots of other possibilities, I'm quite sure, for you. And it means a tremendous lot to all of us that we carve out this hour to focus on our God and our lives as God's people. And this week, as we continue our lives in God's world, wherever that may take us, near or a little further away, may you allow God to carry you, for God to walk with you. May you discover ways that you are vessels of hope for the people around you. And how it is and where it is you go, may you see the face of Christ in the people you meet. May the people you meet see the face of Christ in you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.